that caused this connector to fail.
Okay, and the consequence in being, sorry?
It was in the loft.
Sorry, you said, I thought you said burnt the house down.
It burnt the house down, it set fire to the roof.
As you clicked on this video, no, you haven't already seen it. I've got the same people in front of me, and off camera we've had some great discussions that I think are worth sharing with you. The previous video, the conclusion was, the physics of a conductor, whether it be connected over tight or under tight, has a massive bearing on what happens to that conductor throughout the life of the installation it is within. And if you haven't seen that video, I'll leave it in the eye above my head or in the description below, the link that takes you there. And I recommend you watch that one first. However, we've got loads of other questions that we want to add in on talk. I'm going to start with you, Ian. The screw heads, whether they be on an RCBO, the main switch, the neutral or earth bar, are often different sizes and different torque settings. Why?
That stems from manufacturing standards. So you'll find within a number of product standards for different products, whether it be switches, whether it be circuit protection, whether it be plugs and sockets, you'll find similar information in a lot of those standards pertaining to the mechanical withstand strength of screws and screw connections based upon the metric size of those screws.
So when you say size, so if I've gone from a Lewden consumer unit into a different branded one and I'm looking at a very similar device and all of a sudden the screw head is larger or smaller than yours, that's going to affect the torque setting possibly of that device, meaning that I can't look at an RCBO from all the manufacturers and get exactly the same torque setting.
Quite potentially. Products, certainly circuit protection products, they're designed as individual components firstly, and designed to accept conductors of different sizes. So hence, larger conductors generally need larger terminations, hence larger screws.
Okay.
And larger screws bring with them higher torque values, generally.
And we see that, don't we, from the neutral earth bar, RCBO, right. And then the main switch. The main switch often, as a rule, has a larger torque setting and taking larger conductors. That makes sense. Yeah. Now, this isn't covered, is it, in BS7671? Have I missed the page out in there about this?
None of this information is covered in BS7671.
It isn't. It's all about product standards.
Right.
Okay, and it links into when we talked in our previous video about the potential to have fires. But for me, the other question that keeps coming out is, I've connected inside a consumer unit, I've gone to the top of the 6-amp circuit breaker, I've done it to a required torque setting, and 1 meter away from it, I've run into a ceiling rosin pendant, or maybe I've taken a feed to the switch, and I've done that termination up correctly. Does that need to get the required torque setting, Shahid?
Should be, shouldn't it?
All right,
it should. Otherwise, you're just moving the problem from one place to another.
I've moved it a meter.
Yeah.
Okay. But there's no torque settings on the back of my light switch or socket, is there?
Not that I'm aware of.
No, not that I'm aware of either. Is this something, Steve, that you think should come into practice?
Definitely.
That we should start setting those?
100%, yes.
Okay. From your experience, Ian, with product standards, is that something you could see coming in the future?
Quite potentially, yes.
Okay. Yeah. Now, when we go to our forensic expert, and I like to say that in the other video as well, whenever I could get forensic in. Okay, so Rob, our forensic expert, we talked about fires possibly cause more at the mains end of an installation.
Yeah.
In your experience of investigating these, have we seen that fire problem maybe appear in the back of a cooker switch, shower switch, socket outlet, etc.?
Yeah, it can occur anywhere. I mean, the most common place is a highly loaded part of the system, so typically intake to the building or somewhere like that. But the issue occurs when a connector is undersized and it can't dissipate the heat that's generated by the resistance at the connection. So, for example, I've seen a failure, someone extended a shower circuit using a small undersized chocolate block connector.
Okay.
And it was fine for years until his son had a party and all his mates the following morning showers.
I'm glad you said that. Okay, because I envisaged the party had the shower running on throughout the party. Steve's already in there. Old hair's gone back, he's in. Okay, so in the morning.
The morning there was a prolonged use of the shower, one person after the other.
Right.
And that caused this connector to fail.
Okay, and the consequence in being,
It was in the loft.
Sorry, you said, I thought you said burnt the house
down. It burnt the house down, it set fire to the roof. And the rest is history.
Now, is this a story or a confession, Rob? Is it your party? Was it?
Not guilty.
Okay.
No.
So that's some party to start with. Let's go there first. I mean, replacing the lounge carpet for a bit of spilt alcoholic beverage may be, you know, a cost that you could incur. Rebuilding the property that you once owned is always a little bit difficult task. Was anyone injured in that?
No, fortunately not. Okay. No, everyone got out.
So that was a screwed connector. So that takes us back to maybe, you know, any of the other instances. Obviously, it was a poorly designed circuit, which I'm sure you would have jumped in on there because we've extended it into a chock block. But that is an issue, and it's an issue that's easily solved, especially on the continent. Screws in the back of electrical accessories are a rarity to see, yet we still screw in those locations. Is a solution to remove the screw?
Well, I think with historically we've got away with it because a lot of screw connections have been oversized or fairly chunky bits of brass that have been able to absorb any heat or to dissipate the heat without deteriorating in service.
Okay, so I'll jump in there before you go on in. So I'm thinking you're saying that we've tried to keep maybe things at the same cost, and to keep things at the same cost, maybe we've used less of the Earth's resources in order to make them, and maybe now we're nearer the limits of where it is for an ampere rating?
Possibly it comes down to economics, but I don't want to be drawn on that. Technically, there tends to be less material in modern connections.
Okay.
And that is a factor. When we talked earlier about how tight those connections can be, I think older connections had a larger sweet spot of acceptable torque, whereas modern ones, perhaps you've got to get that torque closer to the mark and keep it there for the duration, and that might not be so easy to achieve. Also, I think we have less of a problem in the installation because those circuits, the back of a socket, back of a light switch, tends to be less high current.
Okay.
And you can get away with it until perhaps you're putting those devices under full load, and then they might not be able to cope with it.
Okay, so again, maybe a little bit on, hopefully this won't happen, the granny cable for the EV charger goes through the window, that socket outlet that's only ever powered the telly and a table lamp is now going to spend a few hours powering the charging mechanism within your car, we might see this problem. We always seem to chase the same issue, seem to change the same problem around the installation. So we could have that after we've had the shower one. Shahid. Regulations don't tend to ever look at anything like this, do they? They never sort of give us any guidance on making those terminations of a certain variety. However, we have seen recently, haven't we, the levered style connectors.
Yeah.
Okay, from a personal point of view, good idea, bad idea?
I think it's a relatively good idea. I've not used them myself. I've not had a chance to play around with them, which I'd like to give you a proper opinion.
Yeah.
But the principle of it seems fine.
Yeah, and I think the levered connector, say, in a box located close to a light fitting, so we trust it, don't we? We trust that levered mechanism. But it's removed, Steve, I've done you out of a job here, because that levered connection, going back to where we started, has removed the need to have it at a certain torque setting.
Yes.
So is there a common ground, or is it a move to levers? What would you say, from your experience, Rob, that you would suggest that lever should be in place? Or would we say screws, or a combination of both, torque settings? What are you going to go with?
If you start talking about these maintenance-free connectors,
yes,
they tend to, as far as I understand it, contain levered connections or some sort of spring-loaded mechanism that maintains contact pressure.
Yes.
From that perspective, it's a very good thing.
Yep.
Some of those connectors, I think, don't have a big bulk of metal. So if you start loading them, let's say, beyond their rating, then there might be issues. But that's going to be true of all connectors. Mm.
Okay.
But it gets away with, avoids some of the problems that are associated with screw connectors.
Okay, lever connectors, good idea, do you think, Ian?
I think on some products.
Okay, I'm glad you said that, because I'm going to flip it straight back at you, and you knew that was going to come, probably. So if they're a good idea, why can't I have a neutral bar, earth bar of actual levered connectors? It removes the need for the torque screwdriver, which we discussed, and we said it was very important, especially in your experience, Rob, of electrical fires, being a forensic investigator. Okay, so why are we not putting those levered connectors, say, in consumer units? Because it's something I've seen on the continent. Another one of my favourite phrases.
Well, on certain parts, I mean, first of all, there's a cost element and a more complex design element to applying it across a consumer unit, for example, and certainly some of the individual devices within. And some of those devices are carrying quite large currents, which are generally beyond the capacity of those type of terminals.
Okay, but when you think, we always think there's always an opportunity to improve stuff. So we change from maybe the petrol or diesel vehicle, now we're going towards a battery one. We haven't redesigned that car, they all look the same. Okay, there was a golden opportunity to redo that. However, as we move towards a world that may or may not have art fault protection in it, that might have been a really golden opportunity actually to have a connector on there that, that didn't require any torque sense. I know you're still gutted about that one. So they have it in a minute.
That's okay.
So, okay.
That's
okay. And again, we're not at the point where we know under Amendment 2 how many more times they're going to be introduced, if at all. But is that something that we should be embracing? New technology, Shahid, and moving forward and actually trying to make life easier for everyone.
Totally agree.
Yeah, totally agree.
We should be moving to ease of installation, ease of use, across all sorts of examples.
Yeah, and we saw that before, didn't we? In our first video we did, we talked about RCD and testing RCDs. Oh. You came out with a simple solution because we trust our manufacturers, and we brought up trusting our manufacturers previously, the manufacturers of our torque screwdriver in a previous video, and the manufacturer of our consumer units. But it doesn't really answer the question, does it? Do we need to be torquing up these screws? Do, you know what I mean? Is it torquing screws?
Isn't it true to say with that type of connector as well, they're designed specifically for a particular conductor size in mind?
They go for size, but they go for classes as well. They do class one, class two, class five. Okay, so they're covered from that, and they make different size, physical sizes for them. Mm-hmm. So the only barrier may be to wider use of a levered connection, which we believe will offer, would we say tension or pressure? What would you use for that?
Contact pressure. Yeah, yeah. It's the force applied to the conductor over the time.
And that's where the torque screwdriver came into its own in our previous video, because we got it at the right torque pressure, and therefore we were worried about the physics of that conductor. Obviously we're moving within the answer, aren't we? We know the answer, we're just slow to move towards it, are we?
I mean, it historically I don't think there's been that many problems with the old screw terminals.
I agree.
But as you say, if you start increasing the loading on the system, then you might see more of that. And when you do get failures into the system, if someone's lights don't work or if a socket doesn't work, tends not to be the end of the world. They don't always result in fires, so probably haven't got as much industry interest as consumer units have historically.
Yeah, and I totally agree with that. I like a screwed connection as much as I like a levered connection. There's something quite satisfying about making off conductors into outlets and then obviously pushing them back into place. I'd always recommend you, obviously, we recheck Titan once you've moved them. We suggested movement in our previous video caused an issue when we were talking about torque. Well, the same thing there, isn't it? It's that movement of conductors and preventing movement of conductors, which is a benefit to us. So as we circle into this then, so we're suggesting the screw connectors here. And you're, from a forensic point of view, not too worried about a screw connection?
Some screw connectors have failed. I mean, I've seen ceiling rose connectors fail and cause fires in roofs. It happens, you know. It's to get a fire and to get a sustained fire, it tends to be an inline resistance that you get. So it's not a fault between conductors.
No.
It's carrying the current that causes the heating. And for that to lead to a fire, you've got to be very unlucky. You've got to get a certain series of events to occur, and it all has to line up and dissipate energy for a prolonged period of time. It doesn't always happen. It might just be that the lights stop working.
Yes.
But if the lights are flickering for a prolonged period or something like that, then that can lead to these events.
Okay. And in both ways, that would have been solved by either having a torque setting on the ceiling rose and a screwdriver that did it up, or a levered connection, because then we've got that reliable electrical connection. Agreed?
Yep.
Right. BS7671 doesn't suggest that we can go one way or another, okay? So but they're not suggesting we do screws or we do levers or anything like that. So where would the wiring regulations, you know, help us, point us in? Would it be through our workmanship, through correctly following manufacturer's instructions that we talked to about before, Shahid?
Yeah, all the same stuff applies. There's different types of connectors that are acceptable, and there's regulations that stipulate that. I can't remember them off the top of my head, which is really bad. Again, it comes down to good workmanship, good use of proper products, and taking account of the manufacturer's instructions.
And I think that's where we concluded our previous video, didn't we? I started out on our previous one actually saying you were all in cahoots. If you haven't checked out that video, again, it's eye above my head and in the description. But it goes back to it. So conscientious installation, however you do it, with the correct materials. to manufacturer's instructions that are provided.
Where the example of the bit of chalk block
yes.
on the shower, that doesn't, it obviously, it contravenes the fundamental principle of 7671.
It does. And
good workmanship.
Up until the point of the connector block, that circuit was correct, wasn't it? It was the point of which whoever took on the engineering judgment from that point forward caused the point of failure.
That's right. Was it in an enclosure? Or was it just a bit of chalk block that was hanging up in the... Yeah. In the roof space.
And I'd like to suggest that isn't the electrician. Okay, I'd like to defend anyone who's currently diving in with the comments, because we are all of the things that we suggested. So we will be installing them as required and by a BS7671 using the correct tools and equipment. And as we said in our previous video, Rob, that puts you out of work, doesn't it?
It does.
I've got a feeling at the end of this series of videos that we're going to have with you and Rob, that we're going to have a bit of a whip round, aren't we?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. Got any other examples of fires for us that you want to say? Because I did like that one. The one in the previous one where you obviously described the jelly baby. Okay, have you got any other ones that you think would be poignant to our audience, especially in that electrical sector?
Well, like we said in that video, it's quite common to find fires around the meter position. It's not necessarily the meter. There's lots of equipment there, and it's about finding what bit has failed. But it's not just fires, we've also seen failed neutral connections on three-phase installations that can cause very strange volts beyond that point, which can cause fires or failures to equipment beyond that point. So a failed connection is not just a fire hazard, but it could lead to some other issues.
Yeah. And it's all about taking it seriously, isn't it? As we probably joked around a little bit in both videos, but it's that, you know, conscientious installation correctly will not cause a problem, will it? And it will not cause a problem that necessarily falls at the electrician's feet. You know, it's not their problem. So if you do your job correctly, it moves it across to the manufacturer, and we trust the manufacturer.
Right. So as long as the manufacturer is doing their part to ensure that the products they produce are under a constant checking process to ensure continued quality.
Yes.
I mean, you've got an initial testing and verification, and for example, here the application of a torque setting is the result of a lot of testing to find a particular sweet spot on which the device is happy, the conductors are happy, and it's then translating that information into the installation and keeping some uniformity and limiting risk.
Yeah. I totally agree. And let's use the example of we've seen them online. People order from an online retailer that offers next day delivery a charging unit for their mobile phone, and they charge it in and walk away from it. It's not a huge load, but it's on maybe for several hours, and maybe that perishes and causes a problem. That goes back to what we just said there. If you had a trusted manufacturer, you went maybe to the store, you bought the phone, and the rest, we don't expect those things to fail, do we? We expect everything to go through that cycle and be electrically safe and installed correctly, which again means, Rob, you're out of a job. So hopefully this series on talk has been one that's been helpful, and we've covered lots of different things. And if you haven't checked out that playlist, also I will leave a link for that in the description. I recommend you do that. Also, we've got a talk CPD, so you can take your level of knowledge up and be certificated. And also that will be left in the description as well as you carry on this journey. But as always, we're interested in your comments and your feedback. And if you leave them below, I'll attempt to get back to as many as I can.